Hey everyone, in light of all the recent proposed federal gun legislation that was introduced to the Senate that got shot down, I wanted to put together a video considering that AR-15 parts availability should be going back up and the prices for those parts should also be going back down. And what this video is about is basically the selection of the parts that I went through to build my own AR-15 and basically what my build philosophy was. My build philosophy was primarily based on quality, and which leads to the longevity of the rifle. Basically, I want this rifle to outlive me and, you know, possibly pass it down to my son and whatnot. I also wanted it to look very cool and also to be very unique. Another objective of this video is to let people know that it is possible to get some very, very high quality parts without falling for the marketing hype of some of the top tier brands and paying, you know, much more than what is necessary in order to get quality parts. So as I go through the list of the parts, I'll stipulate whether or not it's an area that you should skimp on or cut corners and you'll still be fine, or if it's an area that you really should put down, you know, good money, because, you know, the role of that particular part within the gun is crucial and you should not cut corners. Another thing that I wanted to mention, at least for me, is that streamlining of manufacturers was very important. I didn't want to have 8, 9, or 10 different manufacturers. I wanted to have it down to basically 4 to 5 manufacturers to make sure that the gun didn't have too many different parts. So without further ado, let's get to it. The first thing that you want to do is you want to get a lower receiver. That's the part of the gun that's serialized. That's the part of the gun that basically gets assigned to your name. A lower receiver, for the most part, is just a lower receiver. They pretty much are all made of the same material, high-grade aluminum. There are different methodologies to putting them together, but the most common is basically forged. The company that I went for is Mega Arms. I felt that they were an excellent combination of quality, but also at a very competitive price. The lower parts kit was the next area that I went into. I went with Rock River Arms, RRA. They're known as being dependable, simple, and cost-effective. The lower parts kit is basically the brains of the gun. It's basically the trigger mechanisms. And, you know, Rock River Arms, its kit was very, very simple, and that's what I wanted to go for. I know that there's other lower part kits out there that are much more expensive, they're fancier, they're double stage, this, that, and the other. But I have heard that the more complicated they can get, they are more prone to breaking. Now, whether or not that's true, I'm not exactly sure, but a lower parts kit can always be changed out. I just wanted something that was simple and dependable, so I went with Rock River Arms. The upper receiver is the next section of the gun that I purchased, and in order to match the lower receiver, I also went with Mega Arms. Originally, I did purchase another company's upper receiver just because they had a special, you know, at the gun store for that particular part. It was a good price. However, what I found is that because it was from two different manufacturers, there was actually a gap between my lower receiver and my upper receiver. And this is to no fault of either company. But I ended up returning the upper receiver and ordering another upper receiver from another manufacturer that matched Mega Arms. It was a Mega Arms upper receiver, and it fit perfectly. There were no gaps between the upper and the lower, which is important because you don't want any dirt to get into where the trigger mechanism is, because that is what will cause a jam. So the upper receiver was Mega Arms, basically like the lower receiver. You know, an upper receiver is an upper receiver. Almost anyone will do. They're not that special. So again, I went with Mega Arms. On the other side of the upper receiver, I just, you know, you need to get a dust cover and a forward assist. It's a generic brand. Anything will do. Charging handle, I also went with Mega Arms, again, to keep everything streamlined as far as the manufacturers are concerned. It was a billet material, very tough, good looking, low price. The bolt carrier group, I went with Daniel Defense. The bolt carrier group is the heart of the gun. It pumps back and forth. It's responsible for cycling out the old round that you just fired and bringing in a new round and firing that round. It's subjected to a lot of repetitive motion it's subjected to a lot of shock from that repetitive motion. It is also subjected to a lot of heat. Okay, so this is an area that you should not cut corners, that you should not skimp on. You want to make sure that your gas keys are properly staked. Make sure that you get a high quality bolt carrier group, and that is why I went with Daniel Defense. In line with the bolt carrier group, the next thing that I purchased was a barrel, which I also got from Daniel Defense. The barrel is the biggest factor as far as accuracy of your rounds are concerned. So you want to make sure that you get a very good, high-quality barrel. Again, I went with the Daniel Defense 16-inch Cold Hammer Forge chrome-lined barrel. No compromise. It was a heavy-grade barrel. I'll probably never be able to wear this barrel out in my whole entire lifetime, and that is what I went with. I don't have a picture of the gas block, but the gas block is responsible for tapping into some of the expended gas from your previously fired round in order to help cycle in a new round. I just went with Yankee Hill. It fit underneath my rail. It was very, very cost effective. Does the job just fine. The gas tube, they're all generic. You can get any gas tube, which is the tube that is responsible for sending the expended gas back down to the bolt carrier group. Any gas tube will do. Flash hider, I went with the A2 birdcage. It's the default flash hider, I believe, for the U.S. military. No frills. There's a lot of flash hiders out there. There's a lot of compensators out there. This thing is just designed to reduce the flash, which does a very good job. It does not help that much towards muzzle control or muzzle flip from the recoil, so just be noted about that. However, one of the upsides about the A2 birdcage, it is very, very cheap. I think I got it for about $5. The next area of the gun that I concentrated on was the rail. I opted to go with the Daniel Defense Omega X 12-inch rail. There is some room for compromise in this area of the gun as far as price is concerned. But I did want something that was sturdy, that could protect the barrel, that could protect the gas tube, as well as the gas block from any kind of damage, just in case the gun got knocked around or dropped. I ended up going with the Daniel Defense Omega X rail, primarily because it was sturdy, but also because it was free-floating, which means that it doesn't rest on the barrel, which helps improve accuracy. And also because it looked really cool. It's a quad rail that allows me to put extra accessories on four different parts. So while the quad rail does add a little bit of weight, its versatility and the way that it looks is what sold me. And that's the reason why I went with the Daniel Defense Omega X 12-inch. For the backup iron sights, I went with Magpul. Very good quality. They look cool. And compared to a lot of other flip-up sights, which are metallic, very, very cost effective. I highly recommend the Magpul backup iron sights. For the foregrip, I kept going with the Magpul theme. I got the MOE RVG vertical grip. It was cheap, ergonomic, lightweight, and very, very comfortable and very, very adaptable. I highly recommend the MOE RVG vertical grip. For the adjustable stock, again, I went with Magpul. I got this particular stock, which is the Magpul STR, because it looks cool. It has a very, very angular look, and it also has room for some storage for batteries and pens and things of that nature. It's also very, very comfortable, very adaptable. It's a five or six position adjustable stock. So regardless of your height or your arm length, you should be able to find a distance that's very, very comfortable for you. The D-ring that I went with is Noveski, which, believe it or not, was actually the cheapest D-ring that I could find. And it's basically designed for sling attachments, and I have used it on one of my YouTube videos. It never let go, it did the job just fine. So the D-ring was from Noveski. The red dot sight that I went with was a Walter PS22. I feel that it's an amazing value. There's other red dot sights out there that are made from, you know, big name manufacturers like Aimpoint or EOTech, and basically for the same performance. The Aimpoint and EOTech are many, many, many times more expensive, $300, $400, $500, maybe even $600. The Walter PS22 does the same thing as those higher tier brands, but for $70. It was very accurate and never lost its zero. It always did the job just fine. Wherever I put that dot, the round was going. And so I'm very, very happy with the Walther PS22, and I highly recommend it for anybody that's looking to, you know, be accurate in their shooting, but not willing to spend more than what's necessary. So basically, this summarizes my AR-15 build. I hope you found it very informative and possibly entertaining. I have more videos coming up. Hope you enjoyed this video. Please rate and subscribe, and I'll see you guys soon.